Kincaid! Tokyo!
South America!
Australia!
Go! Head on with Bob Kincaid. 3 hours of conversation, cussing, and a discussing with America's only born and bred Southern liberal talk host. Head on with Bob Kincaid is brought to you each night by Coal River Mountain Watch. Coal River Mountain Watch invites you to become part of the solution, part of a sustainable future, part of the uprising against mountaintop removal. Coal River Mountain Watch, CRMW.net. And now, from high in the hills of beautiful West Bicod, Virginia, here's Bob Kincaid on the Head On Radio Network.
Well, howdy. And here we go. We're off and running on this fifth day of October 2018. This is the Horn. HeadOn.live is where we live. That, of course, is where you go if you'd like to be part of the merry, madcap, zany, wacky, real-time multimedia extravaganza that is the Horn chat room. Just click on chat room, pick yourself out a screen name and a password, jump right in. You'll be immediately greeted by the likes of Anatole and Ken and Larry and Little Thunder. And, of course, capably moderated by longtime inveterate, indefatigable veteran chat room moderator Sparky, who, being a spacing guild master, has done a real trick today. Just at this point, he's just showing off his spacing guild powers and has folded space to become both Man Cave and Sparky. Yeah, that's something. Hi, I'm Bob Kincaid. And, well, here we are. Remember, this is a shortened program this evening. We'll be knocking off at 8 o'clock Eastern Time. That would be 5 o'clock Pacific. So that I can turn everything around and reboot it and get ready to host the Friday campfire there on the Malloy program. I hope you'll join me for that as well. Remember, listen to Malloy over on TuneIn because, of course, I don't have... I don't have the ability to do the whole video thing. So it'll be audio only, but hopefully we will have a Jim Dandy. A Jim Dandy little conversation in the next 2 hours. Friday on the Front Porch will start in a mere matter of minutes. And then, you know, once we gather around the Malloy campfire, again, more cussing and discussing and carrying on. As we substitute the almost level hills of West Virginia for the North Georgia mountains. Okay. Let's see. Thank you very kindly, Brother Deacon Asa, letting me know Friday on the Front Porch, hot on both streams. Asa asks, have you recovered from your Cavanausea yet? All right, that's worth a cowbell. Cavanausea, that's a damn good word. Yes, it is. Thank you, Scott, letting me know on a day when the torches and pitchforks crowd is foaming at the mouth and is having their way. It's good to know that something still works correctly. Audio's A-OK on the Horn site and on White Rose. That's reassuring to know. Les, meanwhile, the note says, so I pull over in New Jersey this afternoon and call Moms to ask how she's doing. She says to me without a second's pause, the Republican senator from West Virginia just screwed everybody. Oh, if only he was a Republican. Well, I mean, he is. We'll get everything in its proper order, but noted Republican moderate Susan Collins proved that she is anything but. By sticking her nose as far up the fundament of Julius Geezer as she could possibly get it, and thereby, well, never, whatever. We'll talk about that in a little bit. The real Republican moderate in all of this, I mean, Jeff Flake isn't, Lisa Murkowski isn't, Susan Collins certainly isn't. The real Republican moderate in this is Joe Manchin. Only he insists on having a D after his name. Yeah, I know. We'll talk about that. We will. But we have some thank yous to send out before we do anything else. Oh, yes. We have thank yous to send out to James in Illinois. Thank you, James. And to Roberto. Thank you, Roberto. Thank you very kindly to Kevin in Colorado Springs. And thank you to Roland and Edward out in Dallas. Thank you very, very much indeed for being subscribers and helping to keep the program on the air. Now, as far as fundraising goes this evening, in order to finish the week, the very first week of October, even, and not have some sort of nightmarish negative number going into, say, Monday, we need to raise $455 this evening. I'm sorry. I hate it that it works out that way. I wish we were doing $200 a night. But we managed to do 3 days worth of funding. Well, no, 2 days. We managed to do 2 days worth of funding this week, and a little about $145 worth of Wednesday, nothing for Thursday, and of course nothing this evening. So that's where we stand. As far as a Friday on the Front Porch community made miracle is concerned, and those have happened from time to time. I don't know if it'll happen tonight. Gosh, it would be nice if it did. I went out to the we had to go. Agnes had a medical procedure today, and so I went and picked up my meds. I haven't taken them for about a week, and the life of the uninsured. It was a nice, tasty $101 for meds today. So that's Bob. Don't tax the Horn community for your health care. Bernie would have won. Whatever. But anyway, that's where we are. $455 is the fundraising goal for this evening. And seriously, there are bills to pay. There are always bills to pay. Lots of bills to pay. And that's how we keep this program on the air. I don't know who I'd need to talk to pitch olive oil essence capsules to help Agnes lose weight or anything. But that's a conversation I really don't want to have, because I don't want to interrupt the program to pitch some godforsaken nutritional supplement at you. Unless, of course, it's Alabama sex clams. But those things are so hard to come by. All right. So, Sparky, whenever you're ready, if you want to, go ahead and connect, because I don't want to shilly-shally around as far as Friday on the Front Porch is concerned. And we'll get the conversation going quickly. Well, thank you, Larry. Larry says, nice Black Oak, Arkansas reference mentioning Jim Dandy. They didn't do the song first, but their version was the best and a classic. It is that. It is definitely that. All right, I'm just waiting for the connection here. Yeah, it's been kind of an icky day, but we can, you know, we can talk our way through that. And look, on days like this, when things look pretty damn dim and dark, well, this is a good time to participate in Friday on the Front Porch, so that we sort of take a bite out of the, I don't like for people to think that they're alone in their feelings or alone in their sense of outrage. This is a space for that. So jump into Friday on the Front Porch if you want. We've already got We've already got a couple of participants. Let's see what's going on. Let's go over and check in early on with Sparky because, again, got to be out of here by 8. Hey, Sparky.
Hello. Somebody's making a lot of noise.
Well, I don't think it's me.
It's quiet now.
I mean, I'm making a lot of noise, but that's because I'm talking.
Well, I went and did an experiment today.
Yes. Do tell.
You know I have three computer towers.
Right.
So I set up the one that has the old Skype on it up in the rock shop. And there's a hole in the wall of the rock shop. So what you're looking at in my video is the redwood tree.
I kind of guessed that was your redwood.
I'm walking out there right now to kind of give you a...
Yeah, I can see just a very gentle breeze moving the branches.
Yeah, sometimes you might see dove up there.
Oh, that's nice.
But I'll bring you down home here. That's the base of the tree.
Let's see. You got anything you can set up there for scale, just to get an idea of the circumference?
Well, there's these chairs there.
Okay.
And then I have a ladder over there that I had to camp.
Oh, okay. The ladder helps. Now, is the tree? Is it a? Yeah, it's a V shape. It's a twin trunk tree, right?
No, it's two separate trees.
Oh, is it two separate trees? Okay.
Yeah, there's this tree, and then there's that one.
Oh, yeah, that's the young'un.
Twin trunk tree. Say that real fast, Bob.
They're the same age.
Huh. One of them looks significantly larger than the other.
I know. This one here's the dominant tree. And, it used to be my dad's hangout. He'd hang out underneath the tree here and drink beer.
Yeah.
Underneath this canopy. So we had a beer sign up here.
Oh, that's nice. I could see where hanging out under that tree and drinking beer would be an afternoon well spent.
And then there's a pair of googly eyes that my nephew put up there years ago. And then looking back, that's the rock shop right there that I'm going to be sitting in here majority of the time. But I'm going to put the camera back on the tree.
Okay.
Maybe a dove will fly in or something.
That'd be cool.
Because I got...
Wow.
There.
I wish those things would grow in West Virginia. I'd put one in the backyard in a damn minute. But let's see, they can't take temperatures lower than what? Freezing?
Oh, they may not manage to go through freezing. I mean, we've had some good frost here. I'm not sure how cold it gets down. Those trees come from the Santa Cruz Mountains. There's little saplings about 1964.
Wow.
So
your dad dug them up and brought them in?
You know, Steve, you got a mute, man. My mom found them and brought them home, and she planted them.
Nice.
Because my grandparents had a place down in Santa Cruz Mountains in Boulder Creek. Some people may know it. It's near Santa Cruz.
Is it? Hey, Sparky, it's Rick. Is it close to Big Basin Redwood State Park in the Santa Cruz Mountains? That's beautiful.
Yeah, you got to drive right through Boulder Creek to get to Big Basin.
Okay. Yeah, I camped out there. Like, literally, I camped between two redwoods. My tent, pitched my tent between two redwoods. It was very cool.
By the way, you'll get a kick out of this. I just finished, I mentioned a couple of times that I've been rereading all the Travis McGee novels. And I'm up into the 70s now. And I just finished one where he was, where Travis McGee was, had infiltrated a dangerous, violence-prone religious cult that was that had a camp in Ukiah, or near Ukiah. So that's not too far from your neck of the woods, is it, Sparky?
Oh, it's quite a ways. It takes a few hours to get there.
Oh, okay, so that's over even further north up toward Oregon?
No, you know where Santa Rosa is?
Yeah.
It's north of Santa Rosa.
Okay.
I used to spend summers over there on a 360,000-acre ranch.
Oh, and by the way, for TV relevance purposes, I have managed to watch everything except the last episode of the second season of Goliath. Don't ruin anything for me, but managed to do that.
But you haven't watched Matt Ryan yet, have you?
No.
Is that a poke, Sparky? Yeah, but then there's there's another series coming up with, jeez, I can't think of the name, Pretty Woman star. What's her name?
Julia Roberts.
Julia Roberts has got a series coming up on Amazon in November.
Cool. Bob, I got to bug out of here. I just wanted to say something.
Well, yeah, I wanted to make sure we got you in, Steve, because I know you're off to the concert,
yeah.
Right?
I just wanted to apologize to you in front of the horn and God and everybody for just going off today when Joe Manchin did his yay vote. You were the first person I thought to contact because I was like, how can I get in touch with this son of a bitch?
I love you, too.
No, not you, Bob. I meant Joe Manchin. And you were the only West Virginia contact that I knew that could bridge me to him, you know? So I just wanted to unload on him.
Yeah, I understand, and I kind of wish you weren't. I kind of wish you weren't bugging out because there's a lot to be said on that.
I know,
but let me at least give you the Reader's Digest condensed version.
Okay.
Anybody who's surprised by what Joe Manchin did today doesn't know Joe Manchin.
Yeah. But it's just, and
I mean,
know.
Joe Manchin lives to stab Democrats in the back.
Can Pence come in and break a tiebreaker on a cloture vote?
Yes, he absolutely can.
So it wouldn't have mattered then.
Well, hold on. The cloture vote, yeah. The cloture vote wasn't the thing. But he has since announced, you know, as soon as noted moderate Susan Collins
he's gonna vote nay.
Said that she was gonna vote yes, he announced, well, I am too.
Oh, okay. That son of a bitch. I'm not a violent person, and Mr. G.I. Man, if you're out there, I don't mean a word of this, but I hadn't been in a fight 20 years, but if we were in the same room, I might have been tempted to take a poke at him, you know? I was so pissed off when it all played out.
Well, if I could weigh in just a second, I'm not a Southerner and don't really understand West Virginia politics or whatever, but the way I had it pegged is because the cloture vote was 51 to 49, and Murkowski had announced she was going to vote against him, that left just Collins and Manchin. I figured that Manchin would go whatever way Susan Collins did because I heard that he didn't want to provide the 50th vote to confirm the guy. So he can always say, well, I voted yes, and he can go back to his Democratic caucus and say, well, you know, they had the 50 votes anyway. So that's, you know, that's I think what he did. He did just a very, you know, kind of a chicken shit politician-like move.
Well, then, I mean, if you
know,
look,
he is in the Trumpiest state too.
In fact, I went to my highfalutin, fancy new Oxford English Dictionary, the two volumes, you know, with the magnifying glass, and I looked up chicken shit, and there was Joe Manchin's picture.
Yeah. Well, I'm 700 miles
How did
away.
How do they know? That was first published hundreds of years ago. How do they know that you know, Joe Manchin will come to being in the future.
Well, because, you see, hell is eternal, and Dante said that the lowest level of hell was reserved for the betrayers. So Joe Manchin is actually already there, frozen in ice.
There you go.
And I'm 700 miles away, and even if I was in the same room with him, I probably wouldn't have took a poke at him. But damn, I'd have gave him a good wit, as we say in the South, a good wit fur, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And he, and you know what? Just before you leave, so you can at least enjoy it.
Yeah, I'm so furious.
Well, he was given a good wit fur.
He could.
Okay, listen up. Damn it, hold on. All right, I hate it when it happens. Yeah, I cannot tell you how much I hate Firefox.
Oh.
It does nothing but crash. Fortunately, it comes back up pretty quickly. So.
Hey, what's your concert, Steve, real quick?
I'm going to go see. I seen Kansas last week, Rick. They were awesome. It was like dropping the needle on a phonograph. They were that.
Oh,
thug.
Yeah.
Didn't
they
make one mistake.
Perfect.
Holy gosh, man. Tonight I'm seeing Iris DeMent.
Oh, okay.
So she goes on at 8:30, so I got a skedaddle soon. I just wanted to.
Okay, well, so just so you can enjoy, you owe me, Steve. You except for the calling me a son of a bitch part, you owe me no apology.
You turned that around on me. I did not.
Yeah, you're probably going to go out there and watch Iris DeMent and drink Bud Light or something. Okay, so
in your honor.
here's the whit fur.
Hold on a second. Here's Joe Manchin.
By a CNN.
Actually, step back here. We got a nice little semicircle vote.
Senator, explain your decision to vote for.
First of all, I saw that Senator Collins, I wanted to watch her give hers. And she asked to do that. And I knew when I saw she was going to do that, and I said, fine, I watched it. And then I made my decision, and I gave my reasons for my decision.
And the first time they start yelling shame at him, he smiles like a fox eating shit out of a wire brush.
Ours went out, and we wanted to make sure.
You can listen to the people here. Are you concerned about...
Very much concerned, basically, with the sexual abuse that people have had to endure, and very much concerned that we have to do something as a country. But I had to deal with the facts I had in front of me.
Do you believe the allegation?
Willing to be the 50th vote for Judge Kavanaugh?
I just, you know, I never thought of it, basically 50, 51, 52, whatever would have happened. I says, I had to do my own vote on the facts I had in front of me. If I had been in that position, I would have liked to have brought this place back to normal procedure if I'd have had that opportunity to a 60-vote threshold.
But why did you wait? Why did you wait for Collins to make her announcement before you made your announcement?
Because he's a chicken shit. Okay, I mean, this ain't third semester calculus here.
And he wants his cushy job, and he wants to be reelected.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, let's just put it out there like it is. Well, Bob, I'm going to throw a $20 challenge out there to get this thing rolling, man. I owe you that much anyhow. So.
Well, you don't owe me anything, but thank you. That's huge because,
I was in the car with Karen, and I just started texting you right away. You said, God damn it, how could I get in touch with him? I've got to, you know, at least tell him what I'm thinking. And thank you for that.
Well, you're more than welcome, and thank you for everything, Steve. And enjoy the show, you and Miss Karen. And
We will. And she's pissed off too. You know, I don't know how any woman around with the free thinking mind could not be just going out.
Well, just remember, 52% of white women in West Virginia wanted that pervert put on the court, and she's probably about 52% of white women in America did too. We got a white women problem in America.
She's spitting nails right now, and I don't even know if she's going to enjoy the show. She's that mad, so let me try to walk her off.
I bet you Iris may have something to say.
Yeah, good old Iris. Well, I love you guys, and like I said, I got a $20 challenge, and I'll send it directly, Bob. So
all right, thank you. Thank you very kindly.
Have fun, Steve.
All right.
Okay, so that gets us started on the Friday on the Front Porch Community Miracle. We've got $20 on the table, courtesy of Steve and Miss Karen and little Cletus and little Twiggy. If that's met, that'll take us down to $415 to go, and we will be off and running. So thank you very kindly to Steve and Miss Karen and little Cletus and little Twiggy. Let me check in on a couple of emails. Ron and Raleigh with a note. Query, is Jelly Joe in line for any chairmanships if the Dems take the Senate? If I was in the leadership of the Democratic Party, I wouldn't tell that son of a bitch where the meetings were being held. I'd snub his sorry ass. Well, the problem is, though, he had permission, I think, from Chuck Schumer to slip the shiv between the ribs of half of, or a little more than half of the entire population of this country. So there's that. I'm not one of those people who wants to get rid of Nancy Pelosi, but I wouldn't shed a single tear if, whether he's minority leader or majority leader, and more it looks like he's going to remain minority leader, it wouldn't bug me in the least if there was a little bit of a palace coup that took Chuck Schumer out of the leadership, because he has proven himself not so good at it. I mean, it's hard to imagine anybody could be worse than Harry Reid, but Chuck Schumer has certainly given it the old college try. Let's see. Let me do a couple of things here. Matt in San Francisco, subject line, sarcasm. I can't wait until the Democrats take control of the Senate. I'm sure the first thing they'll do is return to the 60-vote threshold for judicial nominees, thus ensuring the best one could hope for is a moderate right wing to be nominated. Then they can put any talk of impeachment off to the side and look forward, not backward. Yep, just giddy with the excitement. I am not. I know. It's a tough day, but let me be clear about something. For everybody who's hating on Joe Manchin, and I'm one of them, unfortunately, we live in a binary political universe. And Joe Manchin is actually, I know it about gags me to say it, he is far better than the pill-pushing out-of-state maniac who is our attorney general who wants to replace him, a guy named pill-pushing Patrick Morrissey, who was partially responsible for inundating this state in millions upon millions upon millions of highly addictive opioids. Okay? That's just a fact. He and his wife are both lobbyists for one of the drug companies that dumped those pills here. And it's inescapable. So as far as I'm concerned, two, I don't think progressives in West Virginia could even keep him from being elected. That's how weak alleged progressives are in this state. And Joe has the Democratic Party all sewn up as a cult of personality for Joe. So let me at least suggest a strategy going forward. And that's this. At this point in time, the chips are going to fall where they may on November the 6th. It's about damn time we took a page out of the Republican playbook and started thinking about two elections out. Shelley Moore Capito, who was... I found it at least interesting that she was sitting. Oh, I see the dove, Sparky. She was sitting over the shoulder of Susan Collins, looking on approvingly. She looks like her dad in a bad wig. Archmore, her dad, of course, was the single most corrupt individual ever to occupy political office in the entire history of the state of West Virginia. She's up for re-election come 2020. There are some rumors that say she will not run for re-election, but instead will try to hand off the office to her boy, who is equally obnoxious and equally Republican. The task at hand right now is to find a credible challenger, and preferably a credible, somewhat progressive challenger for Shelley Moore Capito. This does not include Lulu's, who may or may not have run in a primary campaign against Joe Manchin this year. I would say, just off the top of my head, there are a couple of people that might have the name recognition, a guy named Sean Fluharty, a guy named Mike Pushkin, a lawyer by the name of Chris Regan, who has said he has no interest in holding political office. There may be a couple of credible females, but the I'm sorry, women. Jesus, females. But I'm just talking off the top of my head. But it would be because we're gonna have Joe until 2024. What would be nice would be to have a junior senator who actually knows how to vote the interests of working West Virginians. And that's a remains to be seen kind of thing. It will not, however, help to have people continue to go over and play footsie with the ain't never going to win a race West Virginia Greens, otherwise known as the Mountain Party. So there's that. Let's see. Thank you. Thank you very kindly to Thomas, who met Steve's challenge. That means, yay, we are now down to $415 to finish the week. So I don't know. We got an hour and a half to do it in. It might be possible. So thanks very much for that, Thomas. Thank you, Steve. And let's go back to the extraordinary ordinary roundtable. And let me check in with Steve in New York. Are you there, Steve?
I'm here. Sorry about that. I had it on mute. I was working on something.
Oh, no worries. No worries. It just works best when we don't have extraneous noise going on. But I know you're pretty pissed about all of this, and I wanted to give you a chance to get it off your chest.
You know, I'm not. Honestly, I'm not angry. I'm not pissed. To put it bluntly, the country's finished. We're finished. Because, you know, we can win back the House and the Senate, and at this point, it's meaningless. It's meaningless because all roads lead to the Supreme Court. And I think this really says for me, or tells me, or shows me that whatever they envision, this is not it. And we essentially, I said this to somebody, I don't remember who I said it to. This, you know, I have not read Plato's Republic, but I know enough about it to know kind of the concept of what Plato was talking about was, you know, a quote-unquote learned panel of unelected whatevers or unelected betters was the ideal system for him. And that's what we've got. We've got nine people who can trump anything, pardon the pun, can trump anything the people say. I've had a couple observations, particularly, but and let me just say this to you, I think our Constitution needs to be completely trashed. I think the whole country, we just need to completely start over. The problem is I don't trust
You don't anybody. Trust the people who would do the starting.
No, I don't. I think the country is irreparably divided. And you know, I was thinking about this, or this occurred to me one time, as I don't remember what case was before the court. It may have been the Obergefell decision, where, you know, there was Kennedy was the swing vote. What was Kennedy going to do? And it suddenly occurred to me, we're down to one person who gets to decide the applicability of a document that ironically begins with the three words, we the people. And I feel no obligation to, you know, when you're sworn in as an attorney, you take that silly oath to uphold the Constitution. I completely forsake that. I feel no obligation to uphold this, you know, this piece of fancy toilet paper.
And recall, please, way back in the Reign of Error, when the camera was on Dim Leader, and in reference to the Constitution, he said, "It's just a piece of paper."
You know, when it comes to my clients, I don't give a shit what the law is. If I can use the law to benefit my client, great. If not, then I don't feel any compunction about ignoring it. And I don't know, maybe that's a little disconcerting to hear from somebody who is a lawyer, but nothing is legitimate to me anymore. Nothing. And, you know, and I told you about, you know, I had this shit with my landlord going on. My landlord has continually broken the law. Continually. And lied to the court. And I don't care anymore. I just don't care. I will use whatever I can to beat down and pulverize people who are against me. And I wish that people on the, not even just the left, but anyone left of center all the way to the left would finally grow a pair and stop playing nice. Take a page out of Mitch McConnell's book. You know, I'm sorry, but playing dirty has gotten them to the point where they control it all. They control it all, and yet more people in this country agree with people on the left than they do on the right.
Yeah, I reiterate what I said last night. 44% of senators for 44% of this country will put on the court a man that senators for 56% of this country don't want.
Yeah.
That is not majority rule.
That's a
sham majority.
It's just a sham.
But there are questions to be asked going forward. For instance, if we could get, well, I've heard repeatedly today that, well, you know, the Republicans will probably hang on to the Senate, which means they'll probably get two more Supreme Court justices between now and 2020. Which just about made me lose lunch. But here's a question for you. What happens if D.C. and Puerto Rico become states? Those are two places that are never, 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 never going to send a Republican to the Senate of the United States, which is why neither of them are states. But that's, you know, that needs to be on the list. And maybe the larger thing, Steve, is that we need to have a list. A to-do list, because when you're overwhelmed with shit you got to get done, well, that's what you wind up being, overwhelmed. You got to have, and I mean, I know you in your practice probably have something like this. So does Billable Rick. You've got a list of shit that's due tomorrow, and then there's a list of shit that's, and then further down the list is the shit that's due from 2 weeks from now, and further down is the list of stuff that there's the stuff on the list that's due a month from now.
And then you have those things, those fires which pop up every day that you've got to account for.
Right.
But you know, I've talked to people about this all the time. We need to go back to 1964 when Goldwater lost in that landslide. The right said never again. And that's when you started seeing, that's when the Kochs got active, and that's when Heritage came about, that's when all this shit.
Well, yeah, all of that stuff comes on board as a result of the humiliation of Barry Goldwater in 1964, the rise of direct mail in 1968, the Southern Strategy, and then in 1972 you get the Powell Memo, which completely invigorates a right-wing political machine building. And then Lewis Powell gets rewarded with a Supreme Court seat for having invented the way to pretty much make sure that the capitalist commercial class in this country could bring to bear a never-ending assault on anything that's good and decent for working people.
Yeah. I mean, I think we need to, and I will caveat this by saying, I'm not going to say definitely peacefully. I'm going to say hopefully peacefully, because I can't control what other people would do. But it's time to start surrounding buildings. It's time to start standing outside, thousands, hundreds of thousands, and millions of people standing outside the Supreme Court and the Senate and the House and shouting for people to resign and go.
Well, I read something earlier that people are already gathering outside Mitch McConnell's house, chanting "I like beer," and you know what? Let's be clear about something. Democracy, or what we attempt of it in this country and have, has always been a rowdy thing. And so when people like Joe Scarborough say, you know, "Don't interrupt people at dinner. Don't shout at people in elevators. Register and vote." No. No, public expression is as much a part of democracy as registering and voting is. And frankly, if people want to spit on the ground at Brett Kavanaugh's feet for the rest of his natural born days, or call him an attempted rapist, or anything else like that in public, they are entirely entitled to do so as a function of that alleged democracy.
Listen, along the lines of what you're saying, the voting is the cherry on the sundae. All you know this too, because of the work you've done with AIC, the AIC Act, and all of that, is that the votes, that's the end. That's not the work.
Truer words have never been spoken, Steve. That, thank you. I mean, thank you.
Yeah.
You've got to make people know what it is you want. It's like Joe Manchin saying, "Well, we've got to do something about this sexual assault thing. I believe something happened to Dr. Ford. I just don't think that Kavanaugh did it." Well, who did it, Joe? OJ? Bill Cosby? Whoever kidnapped the Lindbergh baby? Cock Robin? Nobody else was credibly accused. Only he was. But whatever Joe Manchin said was just cover. And what you said about voting being the end, the fact of the matter is, I want to be clear about something. West Virginia Democrats are as much responsible for what Joe Manchin did today as Joe Manchin himself was. All right? Because, and this is just informal, but, I've had conversations with people. And I've said, look, will you at least threaten to withhold your vote if he doesn't do the right thing on Kavanaugh? Well, no, I couldn't do that. We got to have that Senate seat. We can't. And I didn't say don't vote for him. I said threaten to withhold your vote. But there were a whole bunch of West Virginia Democrats who were too fucking cowed to even do that. I got into a conversation on Facebook in a group a week or so ago with an individual who said, well, I met with his sister's niece the other day and we had lunch and she told me that he knows how we feel about it. And, my response to that was, I don't give a fuck if he knows how we feel about it. I care about if he's going to do what we tell him to do, being the Democratic base that he needs.
Knowing how he feels is the equivalent of saying, I'm voting for somebody for president because I want to have a beer with them. I don't give a flying fuck how friendly they are, how nice they are. Do they have the killer instinct to get elected? And are they going to do the right things once they're there? I don't care if I like you or not. I just don't care.
Well, it's not a popularity contest, for Christ's sake.
We're not electing philosophers and priests and nuns and shit like that. And put aside everything.
In the final analysis, what's the difference between Orrin Hatch waving bye-bye at women who've been raped and telling them to grow up, and Joe Manchin being nicer about it?
I wish someone would slap that old fucking Mormon in the face.
Effectively, when it comes down to counting the votes, there's no difference. I want people, and maybe I'm not contributing to it, but I hope I am. I want people to understand why he did what he did. I can sit here and tell you that I have never, ever, ever cast a vote for Joe Manchin. Ever. That I can recall. Maybe for governor. But I've never cast a vote for him for Senate. Because he's always been a shoe-in and he hasn't needed my vote. And I said early on that if he was if he was at or around 10 points ahead, the only way I would vote for him is if he was if there was less than 5 points between him and Patrick Morrissey. Well, it looks like he's between 10 and 8 and 12 points up, and he will probably go up 15 with this.
You know what I would love to say, Bob? Ask these people who are so fucking into this Kavanaugh. What is it? Why are you so enthusiastic? Is this nothing more than the Democrats don't want him, therefore I do? Is that what this comes down to? Because that's what.
Well, yeah, some of it is about owning the libs, okay. But another part of it, and this is significant, is being generated from the weirdo fringe of the white wing. I don't know if you were listening Wednesday or not. Some people Wednesday's just too much. But I played that clip, and it wasn't the first such clip I'd played. I played that clip from that goofy woman who says that Trump is directing a military tribunal that recently got done executing John McCain.
Yeah, I had seen that beforehand, and I saw that. I thought my first, I'll say something real quick and I'll shut up. I thought it was a joke. I was like, what?
Yeah, but see, that wasn't the first time that had been mentioned. It's traveling. It's got legs inside the wacky, dangerous white wing. And they actually want military tribunals. They want a military junta directed by a military dictator in the form of Trump.
And
they see Brett Kavanaugh as the last leg, the last necessary step in having the votes to do that. Whether it's true or not, that's how they see it.
Yeah, and I have to tell you, when I heard her saying this shit, I remember thinking to myself, wait a minute, so you're saying military tribunal, that you're saying that's a good thing? And then these people are the ones who claim to be so patriotic and so pro-Constitution. We always hear that we're going to get back to Constitution. Okay, we are irreconcilable in this country. How can we coexist with people who think this shit? How? How can we coexist with people who will look right?
Okay, let's take it. Is there any way of educating them? Let me give you another case in point. Like I said, we had to go to the clinic today, and what happened was, as we were driving there, I was listening to a thing that's being produced by West Virginia Public Radio called Red State, Blue State, in which they interview mouth-walking, knuckle-breathing maggots from West Virginia, and then somebody at a public radio station in California interviews normal people. And so the portion where they were interviewing the maggot, they had one very passionate feller, and he said, I want judges on the Supreme Court that understand that we have to interpret the Constitution according to the original intent of the founders and not like a living document. You want a living document? That just means you change the rules whenever you want to. You want a living document? Let's play poker with living rules, and then my pair of deuces will beat your four aces. That's what it is when you got living rules. We need to interpret according to what the framers thought. And
give up your fucking AR-15 and go back to a goddamn flintlock.
God bless you, John Bridevo. And the other thing I thought, John, was, oh, you're into the original intent, are you? So you think that people who are darker than you are 3/5 of a human being? Is that it there, Cletus?
That's what the original founders meant. Well, by golly. You know, that's the ignorance of that side. That's the ignorance of their statements like that. They don't have any interest in reading the Constitution. They use the Constitution to wipe their butt nowadays. The same way they use the flag. They'll put it on a bikini and have it watched up in their crock of their crack. They don't give a shit. If it fits on a bumper sticker, that's all they need.
I saw one very pissed off lady from West Virginia, a West Virginia liberal, or on Twitter today, who said, I'm wondering if I can find an American flag bra to burn. And yeah. I responded, well, don't know about that, but I know a place near here where I live where you can buy a Confederate flag bikini, and you'd piss off more West Virginians burning that.
Yeah, that's the sad part of that shit. I got one flying right down the end of the street of me. It pisses me off every time I go to get my mail.
Right next door to me, John. Yeah. And by the way, John, thank you for kicking in. I appreciate it. You took us down to $400, and Catherine just took us down to $350. That is huge and tremendous, and I cannot thank you enough, my friend.
Not much, but it's all a poor boy can afford nowadays.
Well, by God, it's what it'll keep us going. And just to give you an idea, because I got a feeling your life in Texas is a lot like mine in West Virginia, only you got better food.
I don't know. I've been seeing your cooking, Bob.
Well, yeah, but that's just whatever I can get away with on the grill. I don't want to tell any tales on Agnes, but she had to have a test today. So we went over to the local healthcare place, and we walk into this one unit, and this is a hospital, okay? This is a hospital that stays open by virtue of the good graces of the fact that this state accepted the Medicaid expansion, and the nation has the Affordable Care Act, otherwise known as Obamacare. They'd be closed. They'd be dark. People would have, yeah, they're open for now, though. And I walk in, and we walk in, and what's there in the window by the treadmill? A big black sign with white letters that says, Trump digs coal. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, I'm glad I'm not a heart patient. I could come in here and have a fucking aneurysm.
Get his ass in a heart hat, give him a shovel, and tell him to get his ass down there and start digging. Trump loves coal. You know, we all want, there ain't nobody out here wants West Virginia to suffer because coal is not popular. But that's, you know, what are we supposed to do? Turn back the hands of time? Stop the clock? Let's stop everything. We got to finish up burning up this coal before we can advance farther? I don't think so. You know, we push or shove, baby. We got to go into the future, you know.
And I wish
there was a thing such as coal, clean coal, but there ain't.
No, there ain't, and never will be. It is a physically, scientifically impossible thing. It can never be clean simply because you can't mine it cleanly. You can't extract coal without poisoning the people nearby or the people who are doing it.
Yes, I read your thing about mountaintop blasting and all the particulate matter. Yes, that was very eye-opening. Piece there.
Well, it's
but coal keeps the lights on.
Yeah, that ain't even true.
Yeah, we ain't figured out no other way to do that yet.
But you know, not to be a pain in the ass or anything, but there was this woman who ran for president a couple of years back, and she said that with the demise of coal, we were going to have a plan in place to help everybody who might be out of work because you know the coal market fell apart. And by the way, the coal market's still falling apart. I don't care how many of these maggots yell, yeah, coal's coming back, MAGA. I don't care.
You start seeing coal-fired trains, steam trains running up and down the tracks there. You know, there's not a use for it. And the uses that we do have can be replaced with better technology, cleaner technology, more efficient technology.
Yeah, once again, the power grid from coal-fired power went down and stayed down after Florence. The sustainable energy technologies were up within 48 hours.
Hey, John.
Hey, Sparky, how's it going, buddy?
Hey, that lay-down yard in Corpus, they still got all those wind turbine towers?
Yeah, go down there where they're constructing our new bridge down there underneath. There's Siemens has large lots down there filled with towers, blades, and whatnot. Every once in a while, every week or so, you see one going down the highway with escorts, and they're towing it down towards Kingsville, I think. There's another. We have several wind farms down here in South Texas. There's one right over there in Portland. Come down Highway 77, look over there. You can see all of them blowing in the wind. I just love that shit. I just like to see it. So, yeah, they're still constructing them down here. So, you know, we're trying to move away from coal because, Jesus, what's the point? They want to burn coke is what they want to burn here as a byproduct of the oil field. You know, when they frack that, whatever they do, just this big vessel, whenever they cook that oil down to start getting shit that comes out looking sort of like coal. And you can burn it. And it's no good either.
No, it didn't. There's only one energy future, and that is wind and solar.
Yes, that's it. You know,
geothermal
we have a geothermal plant up here somewhere up south of Galveston, I believe, somewhere up in that area. You know, so there are still people that are trying. You know, the time is going to march forward regardless of what this generation says. you know, it, like anything else, coal is a finite reserve. Sooner or later, you're going to run out of the shit. What are you going to do then? You know, I'm just tired of the shit of how come I see, like in Europe and in Japan, like high-speed rail and internet fast service all across the country. Shit, we're still chugging along over here. You know, we're not known for advancing our technology real fast. We're good for developing it, but just...
Well, the sad thing is, we used to be.
We used to be the leader in the world.
But
actually,
I guess
it was 20 years ago during the Clinton years, we were the leader in the world at this kind of stuff. That's... You know, now we're like in the backwaters.
Yeah. Well.
Now
it's all about money for the corporations, baby. It ain't about the future. It's how much money you can grab right now.
Well, let me check in. Let me check in with Hung Like Jesus. He's with us this evening too. What do you say, Hung?
Hey, everybody. I'm just amazed. You know, I woke up this afternoon after taking a nap, and they had Susan Collins on there. Bullshit. How long does it take?
Yes. 5 minutes of bullshit.
I couldn't. You know, just say yes and get off the screen. But the biggest mystery to me is these men and these women with daughters. Did you ever think that these daughters of yours are going to run into some asshole like the one that you just voted to go on the Supreme Court or Trump or more? You think about these things. You have daughters. What do you think they're going to go through when you start just giving this stuff to okay all the time?
That's true.
Yeah, and I mean...
They're worried about their sons now. Yo, because all them lying bitches going to come out of the woodwork, and they're all going to be making up stories about my wonderful son.
Yeah.
That's the message that they're trying to push right now. It's not about your daughter. It's about your son. They're trying to change that paradigm of how we look at it. No, women can't be trusted. Well, you know, they have a funny memory. Well, you know, she can't remember exactly what time it was. She didn't take a photograph of anybody who was there. Why would we believe her?
She don't even remember what color panties she was wearing. How can we trust her?
How can we trust her? And it just, it is trying to turn that wave, into they are the victims. Bullshit. It's working amongst a certain part of our population. It's working, and that's what bothers me. Are they so ignorant? Are you shitting me? Please, you know, I was not a happy camper on my show today, Bob.
I have no doubt, but you know, at least you've still got some momentum and somebody worth rooting for and working for down there, John.
We're gonna take Texas, baby. We're going to chase Ted Cruz out of this state on a rail. I want him gone. And Beto's the man to do it. I am so, you know, every time y'all bring him up, I get giddy. Because he just got a new commercial out, and it's just him facing the camera in it might be his living room or something, speaking about the future and whether or not we have to look at each other, not as Republicans and Democrats, but as Texans and Americans, and we can return that faith back into. It was an inspiring little few-second speech, you know. And you know, I don't know. It's hard to, just a little while ago when y'all were talking about the Constitution, the first three words, "We the People," and discussing about how this change in the court is going to change for a generation, and it will. But Mitch McConnell played the long game. This started years ago, and he held to his game plan, and he got what he wanted. He shoved it in our face, "Kiss my ass, I'll do what I want to do." And that's what we need to do when we take power. Yes, this blue wave needs to come through. It needs to take the House and the Senate if we can. But even if it's just the House, you start there. You start the fight there. Because we have to do it for the long game, because the short game's screwed, baby. That guy's going on the court. There's nothing we can do. We have to start convincing these young people that this is their game, baby. I can't believe how much you just lost. You know?
Well, another one of those stay classy Republican Party moments, the sleazy white wing rag, the Daily Caller.
Yes.
They sent a camera crew to the Hart Senate office building and started passing out beers to sexual assault survivors to ask them if they like Kavanaugh, like beer.
I like beer. I still like beer. I like to drink beer. Did everybody get that message?
If I was the victim of that sexual assault, I would have shaken the beer up and opened it up and, you know, splattered it all over the person who had handed it to me. Mm-hmm. You know.
And by the way, the White Wingers went absolutely bananas when Murkowski announced that she would not support Kavanaugh. Of course, that was a big joke. That was a game. I hope nobody actually took that for anything more than show politics. There was a calculation made. Flake ain't running. Collins isn't running, and Murkowski isn't running. But Murkowski is in jeopardy, more in jeopardy than Collins is. So Mitch McConnell talked her and talked Collins into saying yes, so that Murkowski could say no and get the natives off her back. And then dumped it in Joe Manchin's lap to be the deciding vote. And Joe Manchin followed up by saying, "I feel terrible for survivors of sexual assault, but I don't think Kavanaugh's going to take health care away from West Virginians."
Yeah. Not until he's sworn in.
Yeah, just like Kavanaugh's not going to take away Roe versus Wade from women, you know.
Right, and he's not. He's going to attack Planned Parenthood versus Casey. Steve, Steve helped us and made that clear.
Yeah.
Let me run over to the stress line and check in with Scott. Hey, Scott.
Hey, Bob and Rick and John and Steve, who's going to the concert, and Sparky and whoever else is heavy breathing on the line. I've got a question, and it occurred to me, and by the way, Bob, I'm sorry I've been out of the loop for the past week or so. I just got to the point where I started gnawing on furniture watching these damn hearings, and I said, well, I can't go into overload or it's going to kill me. So I have to take a little rest, but sanity's sake. But I was thinking, watching Kavanaugh do his ode to a foamy brew in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee, what is he thinking? He's Tom T. Hall? Didn't Tom T. Hall have a song, "I Like Beer"?
Mm-hmm. It makes me a jolly good fellow.
Yeah. I don't know the voices real well sometimes. Someone earlier, you were talking about tribunals, and they bumped off McCain.
Yeah.
I've got a TV viewing tip, and I'm sorry Steve, unless he's listening in the car, won't hear this. The other night, PBS played an episode of a series called POV, meaning point of view. And if you Google POV PBS, the first hit that comes up is the website for point of view, POV. And go to video, and then click the video Dark Money. I'm telling you, the things that were covered in that documentary will curl your hair. Well, the title says it all, Dark Money. And one of the things that they were talking about is with the House and Senate, as they're currently constituted, being run by the GOP, with the Supreme Court very likely being GOP controlled, it's part of their plan. And I don't mean to sound like a conspiracy nut, but, you know, if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck and chips like a duck, then, I don't know, it's a duck.
If it steps like a goose.
Yeah. Well, there you go. Give yourself a cowbell. But I just watched that documentary, Dark Money, POV, and I swear it'll scare the fluorescent piss out of you.
Get ready for more of it.
I know. I've got a question for John or Bob or whoever. You mentioned Siemens having a wind farm down there in the outskirts of Corpus.
Yes, sir.
Isn't Siemens a German company?
I believe it is. I don't quote me on that, but I believe it is.
Ja, es ist.
Okay.
straight from a German. There you go.
But
yes, they have a large section of our port area, you know, down here.
Well, I haven't been down there for quite a while. Well, since the 90s when I lived there, but I can imagine. Now, here's something interesting, and maybe on the plus side regarding wind farms. Do the conservative activists show up around the perimeter of the wind farm and prevent people who provide that service from going in to do their work? I mean, like you would find them at an abortion clinic or a Planned Parenthood clinic?
No, no. Nobody tried to stop that wind farm.
Maybe they don't oppose it. Maybe they don't oppose everything intelligent and progressive.
No, they don't. And I don't believe the people of West Virginia totally believe that coal is the answer to the future. I think everybody in America knows it's not, and that we have wind, solar, and geothermal, stuff like that. That is going to be the future. We're just desperately trying to hold on to the past here. You know,
well,
back when America was great, you know.
But yeah, make America black long again, which actually happens to be true.
Yes, yeah.
I take it that you all watched the proceedings today from the floor of the Senate.
Watched or listened.
Yeah. Well, I was out and about. See, the highlight of the day, as shitty as the news cycle has been this past 24 hours and going into tomorrow, it's a pretty scary thing when the highlight of today is I got a kick-ass haircut. And if anybody is in San Diego and is in need of treatment of their follicles, go to Supercuts in Hillcrest and ask for Sarah. She'll treat you right.
There you go.
But I can't tell you how, because my hair is such that it's easy for someone who's not paying attention to my instructions to fuck it up, okay? And when they do, it grows out fucked up. You know, it starts bad and it continues bad. Well, she did it right. And my only complaint with Supercuts is when it's time to go back for another haircut, the staff has changed. So maybe
I'm afraid I got to go by Bosley's place before I go get a haircut.
Wait a minute. You're on other end, you're not bald. You're just too tall for your hair, John. Come on. But I was thinking of you when I wrote this today, because I finally had to turn it off the Senate debate when you know who from Texas came along, and it inspired me. So I'll repeat it here. Let me state for the record, clearly, unequivocally, and without fear of contradiction, that the GOP-controlled U.S. Senate contains no bigger fuckwad than Ted Cruz. And when
amen to that, brother.
When one contemplates the collection of reprobates that constitute that side of the aisle, this is truly saying something.
Mm-mm.
So,
yes, sir. Anyway. We're trying our best to get rid of his ass.
Rafaelito Eduardo Cruz, the anointed booger-eating future king of America.
That's him, Bob. You got him nailed, buddy.
And the funny thing is, John, I don't know if you realize this, but every part of that moniker is documentable and provable.
I know.
Did he really eat the boogers?
Oh yeah. There's video of him LARPing the booger.
I don't want to see it.
But there's also a video of him and his nasty old daddy who forgot to become an American for a really long time.
Wasn't important at the time.
Gathered with a bunch of other snake handlers and tongue speakers and strychnine swiggers and floor rollers, and they're pouring oil on Rafaelito's head and anointing him before the Lord, and declaring him that he's going to be the king of America.
Lordy, he missed his shot, buddy. He got beat out by the Antichrist. Are you shitting me?
They did that shit up in Alaska some years ago with Sarah Palin. You remember that video?
Yeah, but they only prayed to protect her from witches. They didn't declare her queen.
No, correction, masturbating witches.
Mm-mm-mm.
Who was that girl, that woman in Delaware that ran for...
Oh, Christine O'Donnell. I'm not a witch. Oh, I'm you.
Yeah, I'm you. I'm you.
Hey. Anyway.
Yeah.
What happened to the tree?
Huh? Oh,
I'm just...
I need your word-knowing skills for a moment, Bob.
See?
The word that I'm looking for, and you've got the fucking Oxford Dictionary. I don't. It's not doppelganger. What is the word for an entity that comes back from a dead person or dead creature to be a presence to visit and to comfort you? There's a word for that. Phenomenon.
To comfort you? I mean, I was with you. I was going zombie. I was going to go golem.
No, not zombie. This is a comforting.
Describing Ted like, Cruz again.
Oh, I'll have to root around in the in the good book for that.
Well,
the dictionary, that is.
Whatever the word that describes that is, I believe Punky has come back. There's a little sparrow who visits on a regular basis, sits out on the banister of the front steps. And I am convinced that that is the departed Punky coming back to say hi.
Nice. Very, very nice.
And I don't mean to get, you know, metaphysically adventurous on you, but I'm just crazy enough to believe of those things. You know? I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. But I would like to think that somewhere in the great beyond, you know, the little guy is regaling people with lovely song.
Well, Scott, just not you mentioned that, I felt the same way about a cat that I adopted after my, like, 19-and-a-half-year-old black cat, Gizmo, died.
Mm-hmm.
And we adopted this other cat named Jasper and Gray Cat. And he just had a lot of the same mannerisms as Gizmo did, at least when he was a kitten. And my wife at the time thought, wow, that's like, you know, this is Gizmo. I can't believe it. So, you know,
well,
I think,
actually,
I think what happens is when we lose an animal, we try to find meaning in the whole experience. And sometimes, you know, that kind of thing happens, or at least we perceive that to be the case, you know?
Well, here's one for you, and I didn't think of it until just this minute. About a month after Punky went on to whatever his reward was, I mentioned it in an email to my acquaintance friend, whatever, in suburban Maryland near D.C., who mm-hmm. is a witch. She's a witch and also a lawyer, which makes mm-hmm. for an interesting combination. And she
yeah.
told me when she wrote back that she really feels my pain and stuff and says, you know, watch out because another creature will show up eventually, and that'll be your departed feathered friend. So I don't know.
Well, you never know.
But
you never know.
I tried during this past week. Let me get the list. I'll give you an idea of just how hard I tried. I mean, I put thought and work into it, okay? As far as participatory government from the citizens' end of things. In the dead of night, I called Murkowski, Collins, Heitkamp, Manchin, Blake, and Ben Sachs, okay? And told them that I hope they would find the courage to do the right thing and not vote to confirm Mr. Kavanaugh. And I pointed out that it's bad enough that we've got one branch of our government, you know, fucked up to a fairly well, though I didn't use that expression. You know, one branch of our government is headed up by a complete, you know, demented circus peanut. Why would we want to have that contaminant inflicted upon our highest level of the judiciary? but I was polite about it. I didn't curse or anything like that.
And well, curse, you know, cussing gives them a reason to hang up on you, so you did the right thing. But hey, Scott, well, I've had a couple of emails from folks who want to jump in on the stress line. Would you mind sharing?
Not at all. Should I hang up or kind of you pump them in? Or,
no, I can't. I can't bring them in. I'm not. I doubt that would work. So
okay.
Not to run you off, but there's only one line there.
Yeah, and plus it's an abbreviated show. But anyway, it's good talking to you and being with the crew again. And I now that I've calmed down somewhat, I'll be more responsible.
Well, and before you go, I got a note saying, "Oh my God, I didn't know Punky died. Arg, please send my condolences." So.
Oh yeah. He went on to.
So but, Scott, say hi to Punky too for us, okay? Or should we say Punky Sparrow?
Yeah. My eye is there on the Sparrow.
Yeah, Spunky. Spunky.
Spunky Sparrow.
Sparrow Punky. Spunky.
All right, man.
Yeah.
Have a good weekend.
All right. Y'all. Later, Scott. Bye now.
Take care, bye-bye. Scott.
And, well, you know, I hope Scott's right. I still miss Punky. Let me check in. Let's see here. Got a note from Ron and Raleigh saying, are you old enough to remember Dick Tracy in the comics? One of Dick's villains was named Clayface. That's who yeah. Ted Cruz reminds me of.
See, Ted Cruz always reminds somebody of the evil guy. You know, the Zodiac Killer, the Anointed King, booger-eating thing. Nobody likes Ted Cruz. Even in the Senate, nobody likes Ted Cruz. He's an embarrassment to my state.
Well, and you know, he's not, I mean, to be fair, he's not really a Texan.
No, he's not.
He's a Cubanadian.
Yes. He came down here trying to convince white folk he's a racist. You know, he's an idiot. Look at me, I'm just like y'all. I hate him too. You know, that's what Ted Cruz.
You know, and the proof in the pudding there, John, is the fact that a family was canvassing in a neighborhood for Beto, and they just happened to be wrong colored.
Oh, well, you can't have that now. No.
Call
911.
And a cranky old white man came out and said, y'all need to get out of my neighborhood and go back where you come from.
Ain't that sad. You see, I heard a story, Rush Limbnick is out there pushing that same theory. It is an attack on the white male, and it's the Christian white male. That's, you know, this whole blue wave, this whole liberal, and you know, tutu wearing liberals, you know, we're all after the white evangelical Christian man. You know, I am, because I want to slap him in the face with a piece of bloody liver and tell him to wake up. No, Jesus did not put Trump in the White House. You know, today, one of my wife's family members, thank goodness their prayer circle has won, and Brett Kavanaugh is going to be confirmed because of their prayer circle. You know, I don't like to dump on people's religion, but bullshit, kiss my ass. He can put a Supreme Court judge on there, but he can't cure cancer? What the hell? You know, is he just a political junkie? You know?
Well, you know, and he can, and he's also very, very good, John, at hitting a double covered receiver on a crossing route.
Yeah.
And keeping him from getting his noggin taken off by a linebacker and a free safety, and having the receiver get all the way into the end zone, especially if said receiver plays for, say, Alabama, Georgia, Mississippi, Tennessee. North Carolina, South Carolina, Clemson, Arkansas, Ole Miss, Mississippi State, LSU, Texas, TCU, Oklahoma, Texas Tech. Yep. You know, you got the idea.
Yeah. Yep. He's too busy with the ball games and judges and all that shit to cure the world's, you know, problems. But, you know, keep sending in those tithes because Jesus needs your money, baby. You know, I'm sorry. I just had that little post when she said their prayer circle worked. Really? You know, it just chaps my ass. That's what your religion means to you? That's just disgusting. You know.
Well, you know, because there aren't any hungry people left in the world.
No. Got that. We got that fixed, didn't we? Somebody said we. I think I see the thing on the internet. Said, "Yep, had that fixed. Jesus did it." That's what I mean, Bob. There's this world in the world, not just here in the United States. You know, a lot of us that were both blessed and cursed with going to a foreign country, not at the best of circumstances, and seeing what life is really like. You know, it's you come back here, baby. It's easy to take a lot of shit for granted. There's a whole lot of this world suffering. And a lot of it suffering in the name of religion. You know, only here in the United States and in the Middle East is the only places where religion is key to politics, you know. Here in the Americas, you got to believe in Jesus and God and all that other shit. I mean, over in the Middle East, well, it's the same way over there, you know.
Well, you know, when I was across the pond, they were astonished that people even refer to deities. That we even refer to deities anymore.
No, nobody in other countries' politics do they make it a thing that you got to believe in this religion or buddy you're not going to get elected. And every year they show the numbers of people that believe religiously are going down. You know, you're gonna thank goodness that God put Kavanaugh on the Supreme Court. Why didn't God kick them priests in the ass when they were abusing them kids? You know, you're blinded by a million-year-old book that, you know, could have been written by anybody. Every religion is just about the same. Everybody had an immaculate birth. Everybody had a Noah, the flood, all that shit. You know, I'm sorry, Bob. I don't.
No, go, man, go.
Hey, buddy.
But hey, how about some free speech in Texas, John? I like to talk Texas when you're hanging out with us.
What you got, Bob?
We got a woman in Hamilton, Texas.
Hamilton, Texas. All right.
She was none too thrilled with the allegations about Brett Kavanaugh.
Oh, well, bless her heart.
And she put a sign in her yard that showed the GOP elephant stick in its trunk under a little girl's skirt.
Hmm.
And the little girl's saying, help.
Yeah.
And the agriculture commissioner of Texas,
runner out of town?
A white-winged POS by the name of Sid Miller.
Sid Miller.
Yeah. He said, this sign is supposed to be Judge Kavanaugh's young daughter. Notice my opponent's sign in the background. The Democrat sleaze knows no bounds. Now, there wasn't anything on there about it being Kavanaugh's daughter. It's a Republican elephant using its trunk to get up the skirt of a girl.
Isn't that who they've been backing all this time?
Isn't that what they want to do? They want to get up all over women's reproductive organs and tell them what they can do with them. Well, Sid Miller pitched enough of a hissy.
The responsibility to be able to make such decisions, Bob.
The police showed up, John.
Yeah.
The police showed up.
Are you shitting me?
And the woman whose name was Marion Stanford is Marion Stanford. She said, the police told me to remove the sign or they would take it and would arrest me, so I let them take the sign.
Arrest me, baby. Arrest me. Let me. Rick, aren't you on call? I need to call a lawyer, buddy.
Unless it's a tax crime or something like that, I can't really help you too much.
See, I would. I'd have a problem with that because I would. I'd force them to arrest my ass. I want something to work with when I get started.
Yeah, I think she should have. That would have been a righteous defense she would have had, you know?
Well, how does she not have a claim against that police department for violation of her constitutional rights to free speech?
That's exactly what I'm saying.
She does.
Because, see,
in jail. Let's go.
Now, the white wing in this country has a boo-hoo crying hissy fit with the tinny sounds of a whorehouse piano in the background. If anybody suggests that... The stuff that they're saying, you know, if somebody say gets fired for saying that, oh, I don't know, Santa Claus is white or something like that. what about her free speech First Amendment rights? Well, Cletus, you don't have any of those in regard to private corporations. But when the popo come along and tell you they're going to arrest your ass if your sign ain't gone, that is a direct suppression of free speech, of especially when it is of a political nature, which it was here.
Somebody get the camera out, because things is fixing to get Western around here. It's going to get cranked up. They pull that kind of shit. Try to challenge my, you know, I'm very much behind free speech, baby, and I'll say what I want.
John Bridevo, you might be the man to get you one of them signs and put it in your yard and see what happens.
Well, first take pot shots at it with the rifle at night.
So this was just a citizen who was fed up with the GOP, basically, and the Kavanaugh thing, right?
Yeah.
This wasn't a candidate, was it?
GOP.
No. But Sid Miller got upset because
he made that
she had his opponent's sign in her yard too.
Oh, okay. Well, and Sid Miller's the guy who's running for the GOP for this office or whatever.
Just down here in Texas. Well,
You know, Bob, that's kind of interesting because there was an interesting article I read, a couple articles I've read in the last couple of days. One was by Ryan Lizza in, is it The Atlantic or is it Esquire? No, it's Esquire. And, you know about Devin Nunes, right? The ne'er-do-well Republican head of the Intelligence Committee in the House.
Yeah, you mean the Russian asset? The Russian asset? Yes.
Right. The Russian asset. And he vouches on his campaign materials and so forth that he's like third or fourth generation farmer who's originally from Portugal, and that, you know, his family has a farm in Tulare County or whatever county he is from and represents. Well, it turns out that the family sold the farm back in like 2006, and they now have a farm in Western Iowa, and actually Steve King's district, some small town in Iowa, I forget what it is. And so Ryan Lizza was going to investigate that. It's like, okay, what's the deal with this? And what he ultimately found is that, the farmers there, they're like 79%, the county voted 79% for Trump, okay, 79-19 or whatever the hell it was. And yet everybody is pretty much, is pretty much against the ICE stormtroopers coming in and clamping down on things. Well, it turns out that the only way these dairy farms can be competitive is if they employ illegal immigrants, because they can pay them less money than white people would, you know? And so, Ryan Lizza, tried to interview Devin Nunes. His brother and his father and mother and the sister-in-law run this dairy farm, and tried to interview them in connection with the story to find out, did you guys, you guys sold your farm in, Tulare County, and then you moved to Iowa? What's the deal here? And so they were like following Ryan Lizza all over the place. And, they were definitely afraid of being busted by ICE. You know, they're against the ICE policies, but they're in favor of the, they're against the ICE policies as applied to their business. Okay. But in general, they're anti-illegal immigration. And I guess the whole point of this story was that, at least the story I'm telling now, is that there was a web designer who ever lived in town who, had a website and told people not to relocate to this town because they have some really nasty disposals like animal waste and stuff, it really stinks. And so he was like threatened by the city, told by the city to take his website down. And he refused and sued him and won First Amendment claim. So, I mean, that's what you got to do with these against these right wingers is, that's the only thing they understand is litigation and smashing right back.
Well,
So it was pretty interesting. I mean, clearly the guy, you know, and the thing is they were hiding the fact of the transfer of the farm from everybody for like the last 12 or 13 years. You know?
Can everybody hear me?
Yep, gotcha. Yeah. 10-4.
No, I didn't hear you, Sparky.
Now I'm on the other computer. The computer in the rock shop is locked up tighter than a drum.
Oh, shit. I see your hat there, buddy.
My mouse quit working.
Oh, well, you know, you were.
I think you need to try some rats there, Sparky.
Look, I mean, we know you're a spacing guild master, but, you know, when you try to fold space in three different directions, that's a little bit much. I don't care what kind of spice you got.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
But luckily this other computer I was able to join the call on.
Well, thank heaven for small favors in that regard. Hey, let me check in with a little bit of email. By the way, we got 30 minutes to go in the program, and we are at $350 to go to finish the week so that we don't have a $550 fundraising goal come Monday. So $350 to go, and thanks to everybody who's jumped in. Hopefully we'll knock it down and have another one of those little community-made Friday on the Front Porch miracles. So,
okay, Bob, well, now that you mentioned it, I'm going to do a payday challenge. I'm going to throw in 20, and I'll double it if somebody matches it.
Okay, cool. So there's 20 on the table. 20 comes in. 20 gets added so that'll take us down below $350 or down below $300. That'll take us down to $290 if my ciphering is correct. And I got to admit, I am having a wonderful time watching the first couple of seasons of the Beverly Hillbillies now that it's up over on Prime. You know, just brilliant writing. And the funny thing is, in black and white, everybody looks older than they actually are. But, yeah. God almighty, Aunt Pearl's hairstyle. Mercy sakes. Bea Benaderet was a brilliant actor.
What?
But there wasn't any slouches in there.
Mm-mm-mm.
Just a comic masterpiece. And I still walk around the house chuckling, you know. But that's the thing about greens and possum innards. They're twice as good the next day.
That's right, the next day. I remember that. And wasn't it nice when that's all we had to be concerned with? I mean, yeah. As a matter of fact, I'm listening to everybody on my new set of headphones I got in the mail today. One of our Blue Dot family members mailed me a new headset.
You sound good. And,
yeah. Ah, thank you, Bob. Appreciate that, buddy.
Oh, you're mighty welcome. I wouldn't blow smoke at you. You really do. But I want to. Yeah. But last week, Sparky advised us that one of the Blue Dot family members had found a way to get you some bottled in bond in the mail or something, and that you had taken
taken
to tasting it and had to go nappy by.
Well, they sent me a bottle of Big House Bourbon from Kentucky, this old boy, Eric Hill, I think was his name.
Yeah.
And he sent me a bottle, and you know, today I got beef jerky in the mail. You know, you got to eat a piece of beef jerky. The guy sent you some beef jerky. Look here, it's good stuff. There you go. Well, you got to do the same thing with the bourbon, except when I did it with the bourbon.
Ooh, bourbon and beef jerky. Oh, Hold me back.
I know it, baby. That bourbon was good. So I had a little bit over ice, and I explained to him, really seriously, now that's the only way you should be drinking bourbon, is over ice. And
well, with a little bit of branch water, maybe.
Well, yeah, a little water, that'll go. I don't go for the Coke and the 7-Up and all the other sweet
stuff. No, that's a bunch of bullshit.
Yeah, I don't like that.
That's for people who don't like the taste of bourbon.
But I had a little glass there of bourbon, and then after the show, I went upstairs to, you know, do your thing, got to do all the sharing and the compressing and all that kind of crap. So I had a little more bourbon. That tasted pretty good, and I haven't had a good buzz in a long, long, long time. And I was sitting there on my recliner sipping that bourbon, and I guess that's the last thing I remember. Except Mama waking me up at around 9 o'clock, going, "Are you going to watch Bill Maher?" "Yes, ma'am, I'm up." So, yes, sir, I'm sorry, Bob, I missed the whole damn show because I was drunk, I guess.
Oh, well, no apology necessary. I'm just living vicariously because I can't do that anymore.
I very seldom do. That's the first time I've had straight bourbon in when I was probably in my 40s, 30s, 40s, I'd have a bourbon on ice with a beer and sip on that bourbon like if you drank a beer or something like that. But, yeah, it's been a long time. It snuck up on me. But boy, it was good bourbon. Good bourbon.
Hey, John.
Yes, sir.
Give the website on that jerky.
MyTexasJerky.com, I think it is. MyTexasJerky.com was it. And it was good. I got to the post office and today and or no, no, this was yesterday. And I got the box out, went out to my truck, you know, got my, stuck my thumb down there and ripped the, and opened it up. And as soon as the outer box opened, I could smell it. What in the world? I knew that smell. And, you know, jerky didn't come right to my mind, but I knew that smell. And I, inside was a brown package wrapped up there and a note on it saying, don't get hooked. And opened it up, and there's a baggie in there with a whole bunch of beef jerky, and they're still hanging on the little metal hooks where he dried it. And, man, it really was good. You know, I've had people have sent me stuff that I've tried, and I really – there was only one candy out of one box that I got from, I think it was, I can't remember if it was from Poland or from Scotland, that, where they sent me a bunch of different candies, and there was only one candy in that whole box that I didn't particularly like, you know. But there's some jelly that's been sent to me from Colorado that I absolutely love. And, you know, it's, I'm not providing a commercial for anybody. The guy sent me some jerky, and man, it was really good jerky. Just the right amount of pepper too. You know, it's not stacked with pepper.
Oh, I love a good jerky. And by the way, and hey, I can happily announce that our buddy Terrace has met Rick's challenge.
There you go, Terrace.
So hot diggity, thank you, Terrace. And yes, that means that we are down, if my ciphering is correct, that takes us down to $290.
Well, awesome. Somebody can hit us with $10 out there to make it even now.
Yeah,
somebody,
well, or yeah. You know, not to, you know, we're always looking for subscribers. You know, $29 folks at $10, and this program works out to be about 16 cents an hour. That's what the support works out to. And I can't find anything at 16 cents around here.
You're gonna have to drive away.
You can't even buy a Fiends of Coal sticker around here for 16 cents.
But remember what 16 cents used to buy, Bob? Shit, what? I could come out with a loot, baby. I could come out with a whole sack full of shit.
I'm a little bit younger than you, not a whole lot, John. But I used to be able to walk into the Rippy Mart and come out with a nice little package of smoke bombs or ladyfingers or the coolest ones were the one, they called them B2 bombs, and they were just straight, and they had a striker on it on the edge, and you could strike it on a matchbox, and it would be a smoke bomb first, and then it would blow up, and you could throw that sucker underwater, and it would still explode.
Oh, I love that. I loved it. I was bad on cherry bombs, so going down to the lake and just throwing them in there so I could watch the water go boom.
Jeez. Oh, by the way, Darlene in Connecticut wants to know, John, if you would repeat, please, the name of the bourbon. Darlene says, I have Bird Dog here, which seemed the best of what my local off-license had available. What was yours?
It's called Big House Bourbon. Big House, and it had a ball and chain there, so somebody in prison learned how to make some good whiskey. So.
Now, I can tell you, Darlene, if you can find it sitting around there, Old Weller Antique 107. Ron in the far frozen north swears by this stuff because it's made from the same mash bill that they make Pappy Van Winkle. I was about to say Pappy McDaniel, but he's a character from Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, and he's also running for Senate in Mississippi. But, Pappy Van Winkle mash bill, Old Weller Antique 107.
Mm. That sounds good. Hey, does anybody want a concert report? I saw Johnny Rivers.
Oh, are you going to kill me with this? You're going to kill me, Rick.
Sorry, man.
I'm telling you, buddy.
Sunday night, Beverly Hills, the great Johnny Rivers. I thought he was maybe in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He's in the Louisiana Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He's from the Bayou. And his voice is just as good as ever. Missed his first two songs, which were Midnight Special and Chicago Bound. And then came into a song Down at the House of Blues, and then he sang, of course, the Seventh Son, and then he did the Snake, the Tracks of My Tears. He did Summer Rain. He did The One You Love, kind of a love song. He did House of the Rising Sun, a very good version of it. He did Rockin' Pneumonia Boogie Woogie Flu. He did By the Time You Get to Phoenix, The Poor Side of Town, Route 66. He did a Four Tops cover, Baby, I Need Your Lovin'. He did Memphis, Tennessee, Chuck Berry cover. He did Maybelline, again by Chuck Berry. And then he came out for his encore. He started with Secret Agent Man, and then did Sway Into the Music, and closed out the whole cast, you know, everybody, all the band and the supporting, the backup singers did One Love, Will the Circle Be Unbroken. So it was a lot of fun. It was, I was like in the second row, and he had keyboardist. He had a bass guitarist. He had a drummer. I think he had another guitar player as well. And then he had a four member backup singing group who've done a lot of his albums with him. African American, wow. very good. It was fun. Afterwards, he actually signed his albums. He came out with an LSU cap on. I couldn't even tell it's him, you know, because he changed obviously and came out half an hour later. You know, and people had lined up and were waiting to have him sign his CD. I didn't have an extra $20 and they weren't taking credit. So I just said, Hey, really enjoyed your show. Shook his hand and, you know, took off, but it was a lot.
There you go, buddy.
Yeah. Yeah. He's a good guy. He's a good guy.
Loving your life, Rick, buddy. I'm telling you.
What's that?
How old are you, Rick?
55. Going to be 56 later this month. Yeah.
Well, shit. I'm just loving it, buddy.
He's just a little.
Just as a point of trivia, anytime it comes up, I like to ask people, do you know what the House of the Rising Sun is?
Yes, it's a bordello in New Orleans, right?
Actually not.
Oh, what
the
is
house,
it?
Actually, the House of the Rising Sun is the Orleans Parish Prison. It's a very tall, thin building. All the inmates' cells are on the east side of the building. The administration and offices are on the west side of the building. The only sun that the inmates see is the house. It's the rising sun. They never see the setting sun.
Oh.
And that's actually, there's a plaque down there by the Orleans Parish Prison that signifies that.
Points that out that song.
Yeah. Yep. So it's the Orleans Parish Prison, baby. You can only see the sunrise. You ain't seeing the sunset.
Ferg can play the living bee Jesus out of that, and he does not know that. I'll be tickled when I get to tell him.
Turn that on to him. A lot of people, that's the first thing, if you listen to the song, it's when he goes into the House of the Rising Sun that he ain't having no more fun, baby.
That's true.
Your ass is locked up.
It probably had been the ruin of many a poor boy.
Oh, it has. It has been the ruin of many a poor boy. If you're in there, you're in there for it. That used to be a very bad place.
You know, that is
anywhere in Louisiana. You get locked up in Louisiana. Angola
that's the worst. Yeah.
I was in a place called LTI in Monroe, Louisiana, for longer than I care to admit. It was a Louisiana training institution for boys, and it was an evil fucking place. Mm. That's the best thing to say for it. I tell people that. There before reform came to reform school, you were there to work the fucking fields. That's about it, baby. Mm. And Lord have mercy if you got in a fight out in the fields, because them guards ain't gonna stop shit. They just want to see who's gonna win.
Yeah. Well, interestingly, going back to the song, The House of the Rising Sun, that's, I think, one of America's oldest folk songs, is it not?
I don't know about that. I'll be honest, I didn't know until we're going down there and there's a sign out front of the front. Are you shitting me? The animals? That song? I thought it was about a whorehouse. Nope.
And then
put that in your head and re-listen to the song, and then it all makes sense.
Right. So. Yeah, it's interesting. I don't know why I always thought it was a bordello. Don't ask me why.
Well, most everybody does.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Well,
anyway, that's probably trivia. I don't know.
I've learned something new, and God knows, my two favorite cities in North America are San Francisco and New Orleans, and just being the born Southerner I am, I think New Orleans comes in first. No offense, y'all. I love San Francisco,
I got a
little more. I got a little more history with New Orleans.
That's me. I got a history there, and I was lucky enough to have a little conversation with Mousy, Mousy Clark. She's an artist down in the quarter, down in Jackson Square, as a matter of fact. She sent me a print of one of her works, and it's called "The Call to Liberty." It's "To the Polls, All Ye Guardians of Liberty," and it's a beautiful portrait print. And she sent it to me, but we had a little conversation because she sent the card. It says Mousy and Fritz the Cat. All right, let's go down memory lane. Anybody remember Fritz the Cat?
Oh, most assuredly.
Nine Lives of Fritz the Cat was a movie.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
72, I saw that
movie. And yeah, that's the same guy who went on and made the first attempt at a movie version of The Lord of the Rings.
What happened?
And used that same cinematic technique that came from Fritz the Cat, if I recall correctly.
Well, that's her husband. Mousy does paintings, and Fritz the Cat, that's her husband, and they live down in the quarter, and it just they live down on Royal Street. When I got that, you know.
Well, I'll be damned.
Who gets lucky to live in that quarter, live there, you know, because that, to me, that of New Orleans is just so, it's everything. It's not only the spice of my life, it's the romance of my life. It's so many stories of my, you know, of my childhood, of Mardi Gras, my first, you know, eye-opening experience at Mardi Gras. Shit. I was young, baby.
Yeah, the first time I ever saw the sunrise on the Mississippi River at Jackson Square, I had just seen that plaque that talks about the apartment where Faulkner wrote his first. And you know, you walk around there, you're walking with the ghost of Faulkner and the ghost of Twain and, hell, I think even Hemingway and Lincoln.
And it does. It oozes out of the streets, the buildings.
Yeah, I got myself in a little bit of trouble while I was down there last time because I said, you know, unlike a city like New York that works hammer and tongs to put something up over its history and doesn't like to mark its history. New Orleans insists that you be immersed in it.
Know it, love it, and that's what our root.
The New Yorkers got mad at me. Whoo! Oh, it wasn't pretty. It wasn't pretty at all.
Well, they just need to come out and have a little bowl of gumbo and get over that shit.
Well, you know, I keep saying, John, if the weather holds this weekend, I'm gonna get the 100-year-old iron Dutch oven out, fire up the outdoor cooktop grill, and get a big pot of gumbo going because it's October, damn it, and it's about damn time.
Post a picture, Bob, because I really do. Every time I run across one of your pictures. Oh, by the way, I seen that picture. You standing there in the shorts taking a picture of three crosses around. Yep, I got you, Bob. Yep. I've been watching, buddy. I'm watching. Keeping my eyes open. But no, I like your food porn, buddy. You know, look at there. Bob's cooking again. Damn. Wish it wasn't so far to his house.
That's my joy. Now, you know, one of these days we got to have a horn in, John. And we'll all get together and we'll barbecue and we'll smoke and we'll cook and have a high old time. That's one of the grand ambitions of you know, just being able to. I get to meet a few members of the horn community here and there in my travels, but I haven't met near as many as I'd like. And you know, to someday be able to do that, you know. That would just be a blast, an absolute blast.
Me and Mama keep talking about, you know, because we RV'd around the country in 2001 after I retired and enjoyed it, and but no longer have an RV. Wish I did, because if I did, I'd jump in the damn thing, because there are, buddy, we got about 25,000 members now, family members. So
holy mackerel.
We're doing pretty good, Bob. I'm just tickled to death with the numbers that we got.
You're like more popular than the Manson family, John.
I'm telling you, I don't know why. I really don't. We've been very lucky. We're fixing to hit 10,000 pretty soon on YouTube. I think we keep clicking away, and the same thing on Facebook. We're at 14,700 on Facebook, 9,300 something on YouTube, and it's clicking pretty good lately.
Our
fan page went over 6,000.
Holy mackerel. That is just astonishing.
I'm tickled to death for somebody that nobody. I'm in the street. Nobody would know me if I turned the corner up there.
I'm impressed as hell. I wouldn't begin to know how to do something like that. But yeah, by the way, you remind me. You mentioned YouTube. People have said, you know, hey, what happened? You know, you used to play music, Bob. Well, the fact of the matter is, you know, we use Podbean, and then I let Podbean turn around and repost over at YouTube. But they'll block your broadcast if you've got so much as a scintilla of music in it.
Yes, they've tried to block me several times. They backed off every time because I sing, and occasionally I bust out in a tune or something. That's just me singing. But then a couple times we've had music in the background, and they've challenged it and pulled my video, and then, you know, like 3 weeks later, well, we're sorry. Well, here's your video back. Kiss my ass, you know.
But that's why I don't play so much music anymore, because I want people who listen on YouTube to be able to listen on YouTube.
Yeah. And if you throw in some music, baby, they'll stop it.
I'm still trying to get this studio up to what I would call video friendly. Right. And of course, the biggest problem that goes with that is getting me video friendly, and that's oh shit, that's a lifetime. That's a lifetime's work.
It's my beard, Bob. The longer the beard grows, the more fans I'm getting, I guess.
Yeah, and you know what? I'm not trying to work your corner or anything, John. But
promoting your ass. Ask where's Sparky? Sparky there?
Yeah.
Wasn't I talking about Bob on the show today?
Yep.
I sure do, Bob. I like this show. Rick, we could do without all his, you know, stuff that he comes up here making me feel all bad.
Rubbing our noses in his rock and roll.
Well, speaking of that, I have a chance to see Journey and Def Leppard in concert at the LA Forum on Saturday night.
This shit, Bob, really. Don't you have a mute mic there or something?
And then I got notification about the Outlaw Festival with Willie Nelson and Sturgill Simpson and I suppose it's probably Promise of the Real as well, playing at the Hollywood Bowl in a couple of weeks.
I have a commercial driver's license, buddy. You know, in case you need a driver, you know.
That would be helpful. You never know when you're going to get stopped by your local friendly gendarme, you know?
Oh, shit, no, I got a perfect record, buddy. Are you shitting me? I laugh at that because of the way I look, and I keep laughing my ass off, you know, over...
Flow rides with John.
What I look like, you know?
Yeah.
Different things there.
Yeah.
Yeah, but what I was saying is I've been a while without getting up close and personal with a razor blade. I'm trying to decide if I can live with it or not. If I was to say I'm going to grow this beard till, for instance, because we know that, you know, you're growing your beard for a purpose, and you know you'll shave it when a certain thing comes to pass. But if I was to do something like say, I'll shave my beard the day that Joe Manchin acts like a Democrat and does the right thing. I'd be walking on it.
I'm working on it, Bob. We need to get this goddamn asshole out of our house because I can't shave a single hair on this thing until he's gone. That's the statement I made. I'm going to stand by it. But your hair is growing different lengths, so I can sit there and pull on it. And the other night I was sitting there watching TV, and I was pulling on that last hair. You know how you're going to judge it. It's how long is this thing? And you go and you feel it, and then you... All of a sudden, oh, there's the end. You look down and you're damn near to your belly button.
Well, see, that's the thing. Mine doesn't grow that way. Mine just it does. It's all curly and shit, and it won't straighten out, so it never looks like anything.
Mine's straight, I think, mainly because I pull on it all the time, thinking.
It went white as snow a long time ago, but it's just this sort of puffy, curly mass on my face and my neck.
There's a certain point that once it gets past that point, It's with this thing now. I don't know if I really want to shave it off. I've grown quite accustomed to it.
Well, John, it's gotten to the point that it's a work of freaking art.
I put them sunglasses on. I look in the mirror. God damn, I wouldn't want to mess with that mean asshole. Yeah,
right. hey, let me check in over on the stress line real quick. I don't know who we've got, but I want to make sure everybody gets a word in. Hey,
is that me?
That's you.
Hello, Bobbert. This is Rudy in Arizona.
Oh, hey, Rudy. How are you, man?
Yeah. Okay. I know it's near the end of the show. I just got a couple things to say. Hi, everybody. Hello, everybody. You do know that sites like the Daily Stormer, right on the front of the site, it says, make sure you vote and bring a friend. So people that are talking about the blue wave, make sure you understand that the other side is just as, I'm out here in asshole Arizona. We are proud to be fucking stupid and racist and militia-y. And every day I just hear all the time about, these people, they want to fucking start killing people. And they want to start killing Democrats and blacks. I'm not shitting you. It's a serious deal. Just be careful.
That sets me off right there, buddy.
I went so far as to take off my Obama stickers off my car because I've heard it too many times. But, Bob, $40 is in the mail for you. I love you. And as far as your video studio, Bob, you're beautiful. I love you. And don't stop. I'll talk to you later, my friend. Oh, is the check okay?
Oh, yeah, that's fine. I'll just tell Boss Man Wayne to be looking for it. So, thank you, Rudy. Rudy, you have just single-handedly taken us from 290 down to 250. And another 50 bucks, and we're caught up with everything but tonight, which would be awesome.
Who wants to be that one? Come on up now. Step up.
Yeah.
Somebody call in now.
Absidamtively.
Rick, he brought up a thing that I got into a debate here the other day because that same subject came up about these militias. Oh, we got to get ready. It's coming. And I just have that constant question in my damn head, who are you going to shoot? You know, when that starts... That talk starts about militias and how it's going to come to a civil war. What asshole out there is getting his guns ready to go shoot who?
Americans.
That's right, baby. That's it. That's the part they don't understand. What are you talking about? You're talking about going out and shooting your... I'm sure if there's somebody, I'm on somebody's list out there. Proud to be there, too. It's disgusting the way some of that talk has gone around. Yeah, we've had this discussion before.
Who do they want to get? Look at the guy who got busted in Florida, John. He was going to murder him as many Democrats as he could find.
Yes. Thank goodness they got his ass.
And they're so goddamn dumb, though. So Lisa Murkowski, in a piece of political theater that was so transparently deliberate and designed, says she's a no vote on Kavanaugh. Well, all of a sudden, her Facebook page is covered up with people threatening her, you know, good God fearing, upstanding, Bible believing, Christ centered, evangelical fundamentalists. Threatening her and making rape accusations and allegations. You know, that's who the white wing are. And it reminds me of something. I got a quote a few minutes ago that is damn well worth sharing. Let's see. Let me find it real quick. Where'd it go? Marty sent this along from Werner Herzog on Twitter. Dear America, you are waking up, as Germany once did, to the awareness that one-third of your people would kill another one-third.
Yes.
While one-third watches.
Yes.
And you know, I'm not one of these apocalypticists or apocarev types or any of that stuff. But you can't just pretend that this doesn't exist, and you can't ignore it. They are itching. There's sweat.
It has to be addressed, and it's going to be the real Americans that are going to stand up and address that shit.
But there's sweat on their trigger fingers.
I keep waiting for it.
There is sweat on their trigger fingers. They are itching to kill. And it has to be dealt with.
Fantasy of Mad Max you know, type situation where it's all just, you know, I don't know. It just makes me ill, the whole damn concept of this shit, because that's the answer that they're pushing out there. You know, that's...
I know.
I don't know. I'm pretty well pissed off, Bob, because for 10 years, we've been watching the Republicans shove shit up our butt, use every nasty tactic they can to get whatever the hell they want, and they've gotten it. They've gotten it. They blocked Merrick Garland. They blocked damn near everything Obama tried to do, and now that this dick is in there, they're trying to dismantle everything that he did the ACA, anything. It doesn't matter what it is. Destroy it. Get rid of it. If it's in the way of making money, get rid of it. And
well, what we need to do, John, is we need to get somehow back all three branches, or actually the two branches that matter, the two elective branches, and then we can change the Supreme Court size, increase it to 11, and appoint two Democrats in there to make up for, you know, the Merrick Garland travesty and this latest Kavanaugh, nonsense, you know? That's, you know, that can be done.
Like y'all say, it's we the people, baby.
You have to mobilize support for that. I mean, otherwise, we're going to be back in the, you know, we're going to be back in like the 1870s, the Supreme Court that basically allowed for Jim Crow to basically propagate and continue.
That's how they've won. They gerrymander, they cheat, they obstruct voters, do whatever they can. That's their thing. The ends justify, the means justifies the ends, or whatever.
Yeah. They can't win a fair fight, John.
They can't. They can't. Our side keeps trying to take the take that we're going to be the honest one, do it right. No. I want to power and shove it up their butt. I want to work every day to try to further this progressive movement down the road, because what is the alternative? Coal? Let's go back to that shit. You know, no, I don't want to go that way. Progressive. I want to progress this nation. I want to get on a high-speed rail. You know, I want safe roads and bridges for all our, you know, all that socialist shit, you know, safe schools, bridges, hospitals, crap like that.
Well, you can come out to California for that.
Buddy, I'm telling you. Does that driver position come with an apartment? I'm on my way, buddy.
I hear Tracy may have a spare bedroom, but she's not here, so I won't.
I'll just knock on her door.
Well, I'll tell you.
I'm upset.
Yeah. Yeah. But everybody, I really appreciate all the input this evening. This has been, as they almost always are, a rousing Friday on the front porch. I wish we had another hour to do it, to run with it, because there's a bunch of stories out there. Just for the fun of it, this is worth a mention. Maybe we'll save it till save the biggest part of it for prayer meeting Wednesday. But the Ohio candidate for Senate against Sherrod Brown, he flew off on a jaunt to meet Christian leaders in southern Ohio on a plane owned by a fella who runs strip joints. And he ain't concerned about it. And you know what? Neither are you.
You wouldn't be judging him, would you, Bob?
No, because you know what? It don't matter to him, and it don't matter to the Christians.
No, it don't. No, it doesn't.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't. But praise the Lord, buddy.
Yep. Praise be. Praise be. By the way, going back to New Orleans real quick, our buddy Irish Dave reminds us, New Orleans was once the site of an actual U.S. mint, and it was seized by the traders during the Civil War, and they continued to crank out U.S. money with the mint mark O.
I did not
know that. That's fascinating. No.
I knew they did have a mint there, but I didn't know that story.
Yes, I knew there was a mint in New Orleans.
Yes.
I used to collect coins back in the day.
I did too. I had a 1901 SVDB that my ex-wife sold for a penny. Used as a penny.
Yeah, there was a Philadelphia mint, and there was a Denver mint, and I guess New Orleans had one.
Mm-hmm.
And
who else had one?
You remind me of the time that one of my family members, after my father passed away, took a big jar full of silver half dollars and silver dimes and silver ones, and and dumped it into a Coinstar.
There you go.
Oh, geez.
There you go. Yep. That's what happened to my whole collection. My first wife, she rolled it up and used it as money. All right,
That's a nomination for Moran Monday, that's for sure.
I think she might have gotten, like, you know, 50, 60 bucks out of it. It was worth $10,000.
Oh, God.
I really got in a bad bind when I was in Louisiana back in, I don't know, I guess it was about 81, 82. And I gave up one of my prize things that I had, the very first issue of Life magazine with the subscription tabs in it still, the all the little tear-out things that was in that. I had that, and I sold it the year before Life magazine turned 50, I think, or whatever it was, 100. Or anyway, I lost my butt on that thing.
Oh, I can imagine. Still kicking yourself, are you?
Yes, it is. Yes, I do. Occasionally, I go, damn, are you shitting me? And what did I do with that money? Went to the grocery store. Shit.
Well, it's only stuff, John. That's what you got to tell yourself. It's only stuff.
Yeah, keep reminding me of that stuff. It's only stuff.
That can be replaced.
And by the way, if you want to see the Trump digs coal sign, I tweeted it earlier today. It's on my timeline. You can go and find it.
Trump digs porn stars. That's what he digs.
Yeah, it is what he digs. Well, listen, everybody, I want to thank you all for jumping in. It's been a magnificent conversation. Thank you, John Bridevo. Thank you, Sparky, for hosting. Thank you, Billable Rick. Thank you, Steve in New York. Thank you, Irwin, for jumping in. Thanks to our buddy Hung Like Jesus. Thanks so much to Steve from Georgia, Stan, being here early. Thank you, Ken. Sorry we didn't hear from you. Same with you, Irwin. But, well, there will be another day. I'm absolutely certain of that. Thank you to Scott, and thanks to Rudy for jumping in. We'll close the program with $250 to raise to finish the week. That's tonight and a quarter of yesterday. Hopefully it'll fall down so we don't have $450 to raise come Monday. Thank you to everybody who keeps the program on the air, each and every one of you. Thank you so very much. Thanks to everybody who shares in your precious finite time participating in this little ongoing conversation. Thanks to our all-volunteer staff. Thank you in the chat room and in the Extraordinary Ordinary Roundtable group this evening to Sparky. Thank you to our news ninjas. Thank you, Brother Deacon Asa, HeadOn.live. Thank you very, very kindly to John Fox in Australia, to Ben Birch, WhiteRoseSociety.org. Thanks always go out to the hardest working, bravest people I know, the men and women of Coal River Mountain Watch, crmw.net. Remember, I'll be right back at about 9 o'clock Eastern Time. Run on over to TuneIn Radio and look up the Progressive Voices channel, and I'll be subbing on this Friday evening for the one and the only, the incomparable Mike Malloy. And we'll just kind of spend our Friday evening together. And I'll take the next few minutes and get everything turned around and ready to reboot. And we'll get the campfire going over in the Malloy zone. All right? I look forward to it. I hope you'll be there, too. And, always, Gina, it's all for you. Have a great weekend, everybody. Later.